guys, welcome back to another bonus segment of Wild Wisconsin. Today, myself and Dr. Dan Storm are out here on a piece of Wisconsin public land talking to you about deer research. Dan, let's talk a little bit about it. What exactly do you do with your research?
Sure. So in my position, I'm the deer and elk research scientist for the state of Wisconsin, for the Wisconsin DNR. So my job is to direct research projects that are all aimed to help deer management in the state, improve hunting, improve deer management in general. So we got a bunch of research projects going on. In particular, one down here in Southwest Wisconsin, we call the Southwest CWD Deer and Predator Project. That's a big project where we're trying to understand how chronic wasting disease impacts deer populations in this area here, which has endemic chronic wasting disease. But we're trying to understand that how the disease operates on the population, but in context of predation, hunting, and habitat. So we're trying to have a comprehensive study on the deer population down here.
So how does some of this research impact a guy like me who's hunting just right down the road?
Yeah, so in this part of the state, chronic wasting disease is endemic. So it's here, it's increasing in prevalence, it's spreading across space. So it's a factor here in deer populations in Wisconsin. It's not something that we can ignore. So the research is intended to determine what is that impact of the disease on the population. What is it now? What is it going to be in the future? How might mortality from chronic wasting disease impact population growth? How might it affect buck age structure and how many big bucks you see walking around? So that's the purpose of this research, is to find out exactly those questions.
Now, I find that really interesting. What exactly are you guys doing out here to collect that data?
Yeah, sure. So basically what we're doing is we're putting transmitters, GPS transmitters on deer and on adult deer, and then these little VHF transmitters on fawns. So every year for 4 years, we started in 2017, we're catching and radio collaring deer. So in the wintertime, we're catching adult deer, does and bucks of all ages, and we're putting these GPS transmitters. These transmitters allow us to find out where the deer are, where each deer is almost in real time. We can just log onto our computer and look up where each deer has been. It's GPS quality. We can program the collars on the fly to change how often they get fixes. So this is the radio collar that we put on the newborn deer. So we're catching these when they're just a few days old. The collars are elastic. All the material is elastic, and there's a bunch of folds, and the folds have stitching at different strengths. So as the deer grows, the fawn grows, as the wind and the rain kind of degrade the stitching, it's just going to grow with the deer. Nice. And so, in fact, this will be on the deer. If the deer survives, the fawn survives, it'll be on for a year, 18 months. So we still have some of the fawns that we collared in 2017 still have their collars. Most of them have dropped by now, though. So, yeah, the main focus is just on those first few months of life. So we're looking at every day. We're determining whether each deer or each fawn lived or died. We're doing that every day through August.
Right.
But so the main interest with these is just that early life, the survival over early life stages. With these, it's obviously with the adults. And so one of the things we're trying to do is look at how mortality rates and causes of mortality differ between deer that have chronic wasting disease and those that don't have chronic wasting disease. So actually in the winter, when we catch the deer, we'll take a biopsy sample from the deer while we're handling it. We'll send that sample into a lab that'll tell us whether or not the deer has chronic wasting disease. So then we've got these two groups of deer, the deer that have the disease, the deer that don't, and we're following them through time to see how their outcomes differ. The other thing that's really awesome with this stuff is just the movement data you can get. I mean, we get thousands of locations per individual every year.
Yeah, just interesting from an average person's standpoint of just learning about deer and how they move through their environment. I mean, that's useful for everybody.
Yeah, I'm really excited to dig into that stuff more. We can learn a ton just about deer ecology, even separate from chronic wasting disease issue, just learning about how deer interact with the landscape, with each other, and also with bobcats and coyotes, because we're also putting GPS collars on bobcats and coyotes too.
Cool.
So in the same area. So we can see kind of, you know, how they use space relative to one another. The cool thing, again, like I said, this, we can change the fix rate on the fly. And so what we're doing in the fall, when it comes time to rut, we're going to crank these up to get a location every hour. And we're going to do that through the Wisconsin
monitor a buck's season. Movement throughout the course of the rut.
Yep. So, like, very you know, cool. When do deer begin to rut? Like, how does that vary between individuals? How does that vary depending on the buck's age? That sort of thing. We know when we catch them how big they are, so does that depend on how heavy they were, how big they were, where do they live, how, you know, just how many does they might be interacting, what sort of area are they traveling? It's going to be really cool.
Yeah, I mean, it's eventually going to help me figure out where to put my tree stand, I hope.
That very well could, yeah. So it's really exciting stuff, and you know, we're just halfway into the project. We're halfway through with our deer capture. It's a four-year project, and we've got over 330 deer that we put GPS collars on. We've put we've collared almost 200 fawns with these, again, halfway through, and so we're just barely scratching the surface of what we're eventually going to learn, but it's super exciting.
Very exciting. So what's a day in the woods look like when you're out here collaring deer? It sounds like it's pretty fun.
It's a lot of fun. It kind of depends on the season. So in the springtime, end of May, early June, what we're doing is we're getting huge groups of volunteers, just citizen volunteers that can sign up and help us. And we just get in a big line, fingertip to fingertip, and we'll get on a property like this public piece itself. Or we've gotten permission on over 200 private parcels, and that's where most of our work is done. So we'll go to these private parcels. But anyhow, we'll set up on a field and we'll just search it. We'll just visually search it. It's not very efficient. You need a lot of people.
Yeah.
But you're walking along. You see that little brown football curled up, and then you just grab it. And then we just pick it up, blindfold it, put the collar on, ear tag it, body weight measurement. And then it's good to go. It takes about three, four minutes to process each
and
deer.
And then away it goes.
Usually it just lays right back down where it was, or if it's a little older, it's just gonna scamper off back to mama. Wintertime is a whole different ballgame. So the wintertime, we're trapping deer. So we do that a few different ways. There's a big, what we call a drop net, which is just a big 40 by 40 foot or 50 by 50 foot net that's suspended like a giant tent.
Uh-huh.
And so then we'll put shelled corn bait in the middle, and then someone has a trigger. It's remote triggered, and someone will be hiding somewhere, whether it's a tree stand or a hunting blind, or maybe an outbuilding or a vehicle, depending just on how the setup is. So when the deer comes, head down at the net, and then we'll drop the net. The deer get tangled up, and then we'll go out there, and we'll administer the sedative drug. Untangle them and then work them up to put, you know, collar them, ear tag them, do some body measurements, do the biopsy, take a genetic sample. So,
and that probably doesn't take very long either for an adult deer once you get them.
No, I mean, we can get it when the crew's got a lot of deer under the belt, they can get it done in less than a half hour each deer.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
So, that's one way. And one way and what's important there is, being able to pattern deer, finding out where deer are in the winter. And being able to sort of pattern when are they coming. So we're putting trail cameras on all these so we know, like, who's coming, is it a doe group, and what time of day are they coming, and that sort of thing. So patterning them is very important, just like hunting, basically. And that's one way we do it. The other way we catch deer is with a netted cage trap. So you picture a metal frame about 9 feet long, about yay wide, and it's got just netting sides. It's in the back, we'll put bait, and then it's got one door open one of the door will be open like a trap door.
Yeah.
And then there'll be a trigger wire right in front of the bait. So deer go in there, they trip the trigger, the door shuts behind them. So we use these on private properties that have really good like UTV trail systems. And so we'll put like a trap line, the traps will be 200 yards apart or so. So we'll get the traps going between 6 and say 18 on a property. And then every morning we're running the trap line, so we'll hop in our UTVs and we'll check the traps. If there's a deer in the trap, we're gonna slam on the brakes. Someone's gonna go into the trap, subdue the deer.
Are you gonna like tranquilize it or anything first?
Yeah, well, not first. Nope. First you gotta get
go
on the ground
and get him out of there.
Yep.
Huh?
So we're wearing helmets.
Oh yeah.
Because you don't want to get kicked in the face.
Yeah.
So you need a helmet. And and so someone's got to subdue the deer, and then they're going to tell the other folks, is it an adult buck, an adult doe, or fawn? And then they're going to draw up the appropriate dose of the sedative drug. Then they're going to sneak in there, shoot, give them the drug dose, and everyone's just going to be quiet for 5 minutes, and the drug's going to take effect. the deer is gonna essentially fall asleep, and then we're gonna pull it out and process it. It's fun.
It's quite the system.
Yeah, it's a blast.
So is there anybody else out there that's doing this stuff?
So this type of research with a chronic wasting disease focus on deer populations, it's been done in the West, in Wyoming and Colorado.
Sure.
But I think we're the first in the Midwest to do this sort of thing, but other states are starting to come along and also study chronic wasting disease in deer populations in the Midwest.
So I'm going to play devil's advocate here a little bit. What if somebody, for example, doesn't hunt or live in this CWD area of Southwest Wisconsin?
Yeah, so why should they care?
Why should they care?
Well, there's a few things. I mean, I think for one thing, the disease is concentrated in Southwest Wisconsin for now. But the sad fact is we keep finding it in other places. And so you may not have it where you live now, but you may in the future. We don't know. But it's always good to have some, you know, the best information that you can have whenever it comes time. The other thing is, you know, we're just going to learn a whole bunch about deer that we haven't, that really, aside from CWD, again, like the habitat use, the movements, dispersal, all that sort of stuff is going to be really, really kind of cool. It's going to be really neat information that I think any hunter is going to be really, really interested in.
I agree. It seems like a win-win for, you know, the deer hunter and the deer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, if you're not a hunter, but you care about wildlife, I mean, this can be a problem. We need to conserve our deer population and understand what's going on, and this study is part of that. So whether you know, deer have a big role in the landscape, whether you hunt or not.
Absolutely.
So understanding how deer operate in the landscape and the impact that disease is going to have on the deer population is going to be important to everybody, I think.
So it sounds like you guys are at the early stages of this whole project. On the local level, what's it look like as far as participation in the project?
It's been really, really great. So this is, you know, Southwest Wisconsin is mostly private land, and we couldn't do this project without the cooperation of landowners. And so we've gotten over 200 landowners to let us work on their property. And the landowners often get really excited about us. They're telling us the best spots to maybe put a net. Yeah. They're telling us, oh, you know, the deer do this time of year, and that sort of intel can be super valuable. Oftentimes they'll come out with us, especially fawn searching. You know, we need lots of people to help us, and so that's been very, very beneficial. But the response has been great. Lots of really enthusiastic landowners, lots of really, really helpful folks, and it's been really, really great to work out here.
So if you're a hunter and you're out here in the woods and you run across a deer that's got a collar on, is it legal to take that animal?
Yep, absolutely. These deer are fair game. What we ask of hunters is to try to ignore the collar. So if you're going to harvest that deer in the absence of the collar, go ahead. If you weren't going to, don't. It's just totally up to you. And again, just ignore the collar is the message that we try to send. One of the important parts of this study is to understand what the harvest rate is for deer. So what percentage of deer every year get harvested. So we want people to essentially just ignore the collar. Again, all we ask is that if they harvest a deer, just give us a call. The number is written on the collar. We'll come out and we'll do a CWD test for the deer, and maybe take some measurements and have a short little, you know, briefly talk with you about the hunt.
You know, we've covered a lot of ground today, and this is really exciting and cool to see. You know, you guys are the only ones doing this in this area. So as a hunter, we're really excited to see where this study goes. Where can we learn more about it?
So by the end of the project, we'll have learned a lot about deer in Southwest Wisconsin, a lot about how chronic wasting disease may or may not be impacting the deer population. We're halfway through the project. It's a lot of work left. So if you're interested in the project, you can follow along at the DNR website.
So what about volunteer opportunities? We want to get out and help you guys.
Absolutely. So every spring, we need a lot of volunteers, hundreds of volunteers to come help us catch fawns. And so there's going to be a place for you to sign up to do just that. And we welcome any help we can get.
Well, we've covered a lot today. I really appreciate you coming out here and explaining all this stuff to me today.
Yeah, thanks for having me. We're really proud of this project. It's a huge project. The results of this study are going to impact deer management for years to come.